G'day and welcome back, and welcome back to part two of my Goblin Time Spot radio. In part one, I tested the radio. It did work up to a point. I replaced all the capacitors, did some cleaning. This week, I'm going to rethread the dial string. I'll have a look at the speaker, see if it's any good or not. If the radio works, I'll do an alignment, and if we've got time, I'll have a look at the clock. First off, I'll do the dial string. I've refitted the tuning shaft. I'll turn the radio over. I'll see if I can get the string back on. I do have a drawing of how the string went, but I pretty much remember it anyway. So I'll pull that tight against the capacitor. I'll just put a bit of tape on there to hold that while I do the rest of it. The string goes around the bobbin twice and then back up again. Now around here twice and then back onto the big pulley here. So I'll wind this back a bit. This has to go in here. Then tie it on the end of the spring. So I've pulled that in there and I'll pull it tight and just make sure I can get full travel. And it's fine. Yeah, that's working good. All right, so all I need to do is tie that onto the spring there, that end, and we're done. I've tied that off with a simple knot, so I can undo it again if I need to. But I think it'll be okay. The spring's just got enough stretch in it now, and I have run it through a few times and it's working perfectly. So I think I can put a dob of, I just use clear nail polish on there, and that'll hold it all together, stop it fraying. I'll refit the volume knob and then I can put the dial on the front and then we can try the radio out. I've printed a new scale. There's a little scratch mark I've put in there. That's where this black line started on the old, you know, scale that was on there before. So I'm going to wrap that around there. I've put some thin double-sided tape here, so hopefully it'll just stick to it. I've left a little tag there so I can get the the protective cover off. Yeah, my little scratch mark is there, so I'll line that up there, and hopefully I can just wind it. Oh no, it's going crooked. I can just wind it around there. That looks pretty good. I'll just trim that off. All right, let's stick it on the radio. Now I was just going to put the knob on here, but I should put this bracket on. This is the dial bracket. I won't be able to get to that screw so well with the knob on there. So I'll put this on, I'll come back, then we'll put the knob on. I've put the back plate on and I've also mounted the dial plate on. I had to redo this. The old one wouldn't clean up. It was just too dirty. So I started from scratch and put all these little numbers on. It took most of a day to do all that. I'll turn the volume pot fully anti-clockwise. I'll put the volume control on. Now if I turn the wheel anti-clockwise, it should be in zero. There's zero there. So the volume pot should still be on minimum volume. There you go. Now this needs to be adjusted when it's in the case. It fits into a Bakelite escutcheon, so it needs to be moved that way so it, you know, it lines up. But that looks good enough so far. Actually, that looks pretty good, doesn't it? Oh, it's scraping somewhere. Now it's hitting down here. I'll just move it out. It is scraping. I think it's too far in. Yeah, that's good. So that's round about centre. We'll see how it finishes up when it's in the case. I think this was pushed back as well, so it probably needs to be bent forward a bit. But I'll worry about that later. I've painted the pointer. I'll just do that up softly. I need to mesh the capacitor here. I think if I line that up with that mark there, that should be zero. It's a good starting point anyway. Okay, that looks pretty good. I'll see how it goes. I'll clean all the valve sockets with some deoxit and a pipe cleaner, and I'll clean the valves up, put them in. I've tested all the valves. They're not fabulous, but they'll work. Once I've done that, we'll have a look at the speaker. We'll put some power on. I've taken the speaker out, and with all speakers that are mounted facing up, it's just filled up with dirt. So a lot of dust there. The worst thing is that the magnet and the voice coil are exposed and they've just got a layer of dust. There's no little felt filter in there. I haven't tried it. Yeah, it's rubbing because it's full of junk. It's also got a tear there. I'll take it outside and dust it all out. We'll see if we can get the dirt out of there. I've cleaned the dust out, and while I was doing it, I noticed the cone is very loose around the edge. I think it will come out, meaning I can undo the spider at the back and lift it out. There's the wire inside the speaker, so I'll just clip it. If I melt the solder on this side, I should be able to pull the wire out. And same for the other side. There it is. There's a screw each side to hold the spider on, so I'll try and undo it without putting a hole in the cone. This is the screw on the other side. That's coming out. Now if I lift that, the cone may, there it is, may stay there. There's the voice coil and the spider. It's got something growing there, and I think a mud wasp has made a nest there. Anyway, that'll clean up. While this is out, I'll repair the tear. There's the core of the magnet there. There's a bit of the mud wasp again. It's pretty rusty. I think I will need to remove that to clean that up properly. So I'll have to take these bolts out and remove the magnet. There's four bolts here. I'll take them out and that will let the magnet go. All right, that should just come off. It's got wires on it, of course. I didn't think of that. All right, I'll need to get rid of those. I'll try and take this field coil out to get to the magnet. I'll have to unsolder the wires, so I'll do that and I'll come back. I've undone all the wires from that tab strip there, so hopefully this will come out. I don't want to ruin it. Wow. Okay. Alright, there's a spacer there. Alright, I'll take this outside and clean it up. There's some mud wasp there. Things have got in everywhere. Alright, I'll go and clean that up. I've cleaned all this up and I've cleaned the rust off the magnet core there. That had to go there. I can put the coil back. And I'll just turn it around to get the wires lined up. That's about there. Now this goes on here. Now of course the magnet needs to be centered inside this plate here. And the basket needs to be centered on the plate. So, as usual, I printed up a 3D alignment tool. Here it is here. It's pretty simple. Two pins there. There's two holes in the basket. So that will line up the basket, if I can get it in the holes there. There we go. And the ring in there will fit in this gap here. Like that. Now, just a matter of putting the bolts in. And this all should be lined up. I'll just tighten the bolts up. Finger tight. Make sure that's in position. Just wobble it back and forward a bit. That's okay. And I'll torque the bolts up. Well, I won't torque them up, I'll do them up. I just went across and across, incrementally tightening these nuts until it was a good torque. And this should pop out, I hope. There it is. This is all lined up now. The magnet's centered in the plate there, and the plate is centered within the basket. I've got the cone here. I'll place that in position. I'll loosely install the screws for the spider. Just loose. There they are. This is the one for the other side. There's two screws for the spider. I've done this so many times, I don't really want to keep repeating it. But what I'm doing is putting in little strips of plastic to center the voice coil over that magnet. I'm going to flip it over now, but just make sure the holes in the cone are lined up with the holes in the basket. I can now nip the spider up. Just be careful the spider doesn't move while you're tightening the screws up. And the other side as well. So I'll just carefully remove the plastic shims. And now we do the crunch check, and it's silent, so there's no rubbing. Great. All I have to do now is inject some adhesive around here under the cone, glue the bits of missing gasket back on, and the speaker's done. I'll actually put a little felt cover over there to stop the dust getting in. I'll connect all these wires up as well, and I think that'll be about it for the speaker. I've got the radio set up for testing. I've put a filter in the center of the speaker there and repaired some of the cracks around the edge. There's another little crack along here I can see. I'll fix that later. I'll put some power on. I've got it on dim bulb. The light's on. It's looking all right. We've got 30 watts and 211 volts. Probably won't work at that. I'll turn it up. See if I can find any stations. Oh, it's tuning. Yeah, the amp's working. Oh, I might be able to hear something there. I'll put it on full power. It should be fine. Whoa! It's a bit of mica noise there, or something. It's working. I don't want music though. Oh, listen to that noise. Oh-ho! I have to go there. Right, I can hear a station there, and it's not music. Yeah, I can just hear it. I don't expect this to work properly because I played with the tuning on these IF transformers when I cleaned it out. So I've still got volume. I can just hear the station. If I adjust these, it should pull it in.
But it doesn't sort of look like that.
And if you're worried about shorting out between the screwdriver and the can, these adjusters are not powered. They don't have B plus on them.
I've got to go down to the pub and have a beer, you know, and then I'll see the missus.
Jeez.
There was sort of like a... I don't know how you describe it, but almost a self-parody or an over-exaggeration.
There has been a tendency in some Australian content, movies that did very well internationally, things like Crocodile Dundee years ago,
yep.
Had that very kind of caricatured view of Australia. But more recently, we're seeing much more nuanced representation. Not so much in kids' TV, because the whole production industry is in crisis because of the removal of quotas from commercial TV.
Right, so that's pulled it in a bit. I need to run the IF frequency through here just to get them right. So they're probably in line, but they're not set at the IF frequency. I'll put the Swartz on. Set to 10.7, that's no good. Right, 455. The actual IF on this is 465. I'll connect the output of the generator to the grid of this IF valve. I'll just roughly adjust these. Turn down the voltage going in. There we go. So I'll move it over here.
Almost never.
We've still got the antenna connected. We'll do this one. So they're roughly aligned. You can probably just see in the background, I've got a 0.01 capacitor in line with the generator input. Now with that noise there, I'll take the grid cap off here. And it's still there. It's probably this valve. It's a 6B6 and they are noisy. Let's see if I can find another one and I'll swap it out. I've got another 6B6 here, I'll try it. I put the replacement valve in there. If the noise is still there, it doesn't mean anything because these valves are noisy. I'm not hearing any noise, and I've just realized the volume was on zero and it was still making a noise, so this is after the volume control, the triode part is anyway. All right, so it seems pretty clean. We'll see how we go. Okay, we'll do a bit more accurate IF alignment. I've got the analog meter here. I've connected that to the plate of the output valve. It's got a little capacitor in there to stop DC coming back. And I'll just adjust it. It'll be pretty close, actually. And once again, we're just looking for maximum deflection on that needle, not looking for a particular number. Okay, that'll do. I'll see if we can still pick up some stations.
Yeah. They span around about the last 500,000 years. And it's not just, you know, one spot here or one spot there. There are still a few gaps, but realistically, we can get a pretty good idea of what...
Yeah, so that seems pretty good, and there's no more noise, so it could well be that valve that was in there. I guess I better work out how to do the RF alignment. I'm all set up to do the RF alignment. Here are the coils that I need to adjust. I've made a bit of a mud map, so I know which coil does what without me going back to the service sheet. I've got the generator set here, and it's going into the antenna. It's got a dummy antenna in the line there. The service sheet says to do the top end first, so I'll do what they say. The generator's on 1450, as we saw. Now, I've got to put the dial on, 207, and that's down here. That's 200, so that's 210. That there is about 207. I'm going to turn it up. I can't hear it. Oh, there it is. So I'll put that back at about 207. I guess that's about it. First thing we do is adjust the oscillator trimmer, which is that one there. And it should come up on the meter there. It's going away. I'll just see where it is. Now, that seems about right, doesn't it? That's not too bad. Yeah, here's the antenna trimmer. So we just peak that as well. Okay, that'll do for a start. I'll put this on 600 kilocycles, kilohertz. The dial has to go around to 600 kilocycles, and on this dial here, it's 500 meters. I'll put it on 500 meters. I'll give it a bit more power. And it's down there. All right. So for that one, we adjust this one here, which is the oscillator patter. And I'll go back to 1450. We go back here again. It looks pretty good. I'll just trim the antenna again. Nope, that's fine. I need to go back here. I just realized there's no patter adjustment for the antenna coil at the bottom at 600 or 500 meters. So we're just going to make sure it actually peaks on there. Yeah, I think it's okay. I'll put the meter on us on the lower scale, try and bring it up a little bit. So this is a type of radio where you need to rock the tuner while you adjust the oscillator to make sure they're both peaked at the 600, and I'm pretty confident they are. So I'm just adjusting the oscillator to peak. and then moving the tuning and see if we get any better, and we can't. So at that point there, they're both at 600, and that's pointing close enough to 500 meters for me. So that's it, it's done. That's the medium wave finished. Before anyone writes in the comments, I know I've got 228s here, and I've missed a number up here. There it is. So it says 13, 14, no number, and then 16. So it should be 15 megahertz. To do the shortwave, I have to turn the switch up here to shortwave 2, which is that selection there. These two here are the adjustments for the shortwave 2. That one's the oscillator trimmer, and that one's the antenna trimmer, or aerial trimmer. Shortwave 2 is the red graduations there, and we do it at 20 megahertz. So I'll put it up at 20, which is right there. Yeah. I'll change the generator to 20 megahertz. And if I turn the volume up, we should hear it. And we don't. Oh, there it is. It's not far out. Now, there's another reflection, hopefully further up. Yeah, there it is there. So you ignore that one. Go for the one at the higher frequency. So I'll put that on 20. And we adjust this oscillator trimmer first, which is that one there. There it is. Okay, that's close enough. And we just trim this antenna trimmer. That's it there. So that's it. That's all you have to do for shortwave 2. Now shortwave 1 is the blue line, the inner line there. I need to put the switch up here to shortwave 1. Now in the English sets they had long wave, or the European sets they had long wave. This export to Australia has two short waves. So there's no instructions on aligning shortwave 1. But it's between 10 and 3, so we'll put it on 6, which is about the middle. Put the generator on 6. And there it is. Oh, look, it's a tiny bit out. I'll adjust it. So it's one of these two, though, the only two I haven't touched. So that'll be the oscillator and that'll be the antenna trimmer. So I'll try and bring it back in. Oh, that's about it. 10's about the highest I'll get. I'll just do the aerial trimmer. Okay, that was about right. That's it for the short wave. There's only one other thing to do, and it's this thing here. This is a wave trap, or an IF rejector. This is in the antenna line, and it's the first thing the signal meets. And this is to nullify any signal coming in on the IF frequency, which would go through your IF chain and cause whistling or whatever else. We need to adjust that so it blocks the IF signal going in through the antenna here. So we select the IF frequency, which is 465. And we'll put some power through it, and that coil should block that signal coming through. So I'll adjust this to minimum signal. No, it's not doing anything. Someone's taken the mica sheet out of this little capacitor assembly here, so it's no longer a capacitor. This coil isn't really used anymore, and you can safely bypass it. It was for back in the day when there was, I think it was some Morse code, some sort of signal was in the air that would come back into it. And that's why this was here. So it was, I think it might have been marine channel something. So that was to block that coming in. It's no longer used. I'll just leave it as it is. I'll just tighten it up again and we'll move on. So I've got the radio on the bench now. I'll just test it out, make sure it still works. Turn some volume up. I don't expect a lot out of this set. It's not a very sensitive sort of receiver.
Country within you're in at any particular time. But it has been shown.
So that's about right. That's ABC radio. That's about where it should be.
So soccer is
another one here somewhere. There it is.
Sports Day, thanks to Kia. The groundbreaking all-electric...
To be Radio National here.
For us, and we can measure the carbon in the ocean. You know, pushed, I would say, to move really quickly. I saw Nick McKenzie this morning on the Today Show.
That's 4BH. Oh, it used to be 4BH. I often get that, so that's not bad.
Trialled and trialled really well, famous for drill. Matty Owen with a claim today.
That's the horse racing station, and we've got 4KQ down here. It's gone. No, 4BC, I mean. There it is. So that's pretty much right on spot. This is the middle of the day, so I don't expect to get too much. But yeah, that's working fine. We will never get anything on shortwave. I'll just quickly flick over, turn it up. Yeah, there's nothing on shortwave one. Something there. Night time might get something. We'll go to shortwave 2. This is where the vernier tuning comes in handy if you're on shortwave. Something there. That might be New Zealand, I'm not sure. Yeah, I don't know what that is. That's where that vernier comes in, because you can just very finely tune it there. So you tune past the station you want, then come back a bit, and it's in vernier mode. Very good. There, that's it. Anyway, enough of that. That's all I'm going to do this week. I was going to do the clock, but I'll pass that on to the next video. I think a 30-minute video is plenty. So next week, I'll do the clock. There's a couple of other small things I need to do, and then I'll do the case probably the week after that. I hope you enjoyed this week's video, and I hope you can join me next time for my next radio adventure.